Hi, in this video lecture we will concentrate on the implementation of spatial conservation plans in practice. As with the earlier lectures, this one is also divided into two parts, and this first part is an introduction to the topic. First, we will relate conservation planning to broader level land use planning and make notes on the specific character of conservation planning and conservation implementation. One problem that really hinders the realization of conservation plans is the so-called research implementation gap, which refers to ineffective implementation often resulting from a division between researchers and land use managers. To overcome this gap between research and implementation, several best practices have been identified. These guidelines for informative conservation planning are discussed in the end of this part. But now, let's begin.
Let's start with a recap of Knight and colleagues' operational model of conservation planning. Now we move beyond the stage of spatial prioritization and we move on to the sphere of implementation. This means a change from planning to management in terms of conservation activity. As you see here, conservation implementation is not a technical and straightforward process. It has many back loops to previous stages of the planning process. But in itself, it is the most important stage in putting the plans into action. It would be wrong and pretty unethical too if conservation researchers stopped their involvement at the spatial prioritization and development of planning products and leaving the actual work for others to do. However, it is important to remember that because there are a large number of stakeholders involved in any conservation program, the final outcome may be unpredictable. So, interesting topics and interesting times ahead of us, right? At this point, it actually is good to stop for a moment and look back a bit. This whole course has involved a lot of conservation talk. So, what do you think? What is the reason behind that decision? Think for a while. So, all answers are good, and here I show some of my own thoughts. Spatial land use planning is a huge field, and it is easier to approach it through a specific case. Here, in this course, it is conservation planning. Conservation planning forms a subset of land use planning, and thus it works as a lens to the bigger picture of spatial planning. Conservation planning has the same principles as any other application of spatial land use planning. Conservation planning also has discipline-specific background, as would economic planning and sociology and so forth, if we were to speak about spatial business planning or planning of societal infrastructure and services. There is one difference, though. It is that nature cannot speak for itself as people can. But nature always needs a spokesperson. And this is an important reason behind the conservation emphasis of this course. One telling example on the importance of conservation planning was this following debate from November 2016 in the regional newspaper Keskisuomalainen here in central Finland. First, Professor Janne Kotiaho wrote a critical commentary of the political decisions on nature conservation. For example, the Regional Council of Central Finland had planned to remove all unimplemented conservation site reservations from the regional land use plan. The title of the Kotiaho commentary was "The Shutdown of Nature Conservation Has to be Seized." Next, a forestry representative of the Farmers Union, Mikko Tiirola, replied with critique to Kotiaho's writing by arguing that Kotiaho just presented conservational arguments from the past, whereas approaches based on landowner voluntariness and so-called conservation markets should be promoted. A third commentary written by two local politicians from the Green Party drew the discussion back to the importance of land use planning and stated that indeed regional land use plan should promote conservation. Finally, it was decided that the conservation site reservations were kept in the regional land use plan. The regional council based this decision on their bioeconomy strategy, and the politicians saw that safeguarding biodiversity is part of sustainable bioeconomy, as Kotiaho recaps here in his tweet on the outcome. So this public debate reflects the uncertain status of conservation in the contemporary political setting. As I said in an earlier lecture, the role of protected areas and indeed conservation in general needs to be continually re-evaluated, renegotiated, and re-envisioned in order to ensure that conservation remains relevant in the minds of decision makers and other societal actors. Okay, how does this discussion link to zonation then? Well, actually, there is a direct link. Some of the site reservations that were suggested to be removed from the regional land use plan of Central Finland were based on the peatland prioritization study done by Kareksela and colleagues, which is one of the case studies we utilize in this course. No matter how well a particular conservation prioritization is planned, conducted, and communicated to the stakeholders, it is always possible that surprises can come up in the implementation phase. The implementation of spatial land use planning has the power to impact society, to change things in a very profound way. The implementation of land use plans affects the lives of all of us, as I showed in the beginning of our course. Land use planning is a powerful tool to change the society and the environment of that society. And where there is power, there will be decision makers and policy makers. Where there is power, there will be politicians, and we need to work with them. However, despite careful planning informed by science, land use plans do not always become implemented. As we just saw, there can be various reasons behind this so-called research implementation gap. So, documented spatial prioritization analyses rarely result in implementation of conservation action, or the implementation is ineffective or left in a halfway position. This is true for most of our example case studies also. Often there is a division between science and policy. In practice, this means that researchers and managers do not communicate, nor do they work together in the process of spatial planning. This is also called as a knowing-doing gap or planning-action gap. This division among actors is common in all applied sciences. Then, another reason behind the research implementation gap is that although spatial prioritization answers where to conserve, it does not tell how to conserve. And yet, real-world conservation problems are not technical but operational. They increasingly need the how to conserve question to be answered. There are tricky scale mismatches in conservation implementation. For example, remember how the most important biodiversity hotspots coincide with regions with high population growth and land use pressures. Establishing protected areas on sparsely populated higher latitudes will not solve the burning conservation questions near the equator or the tropics. Conservation is implemented as part of existing governance structures, and they often are inefficient in some way or another. Maybe not all stakeholders are heard. which leads to a situation where conservation action lacks public support. Or in an emergency situation, maybe the decision makers are unable to do rapid and effective decisions. Let's return to this familiar figure from earlier lectures. We have so far stayed pretty safely within those boxes that lie under the title of conservation assessment. Now we need to go and explore the topics that are related to conservation implementation. Because of the research implementation gap or the planning action gap, spatial prioritizations end up only rarely in official land use plans. Spatial plans are always context specific and they need to specify what is to be done, where it should be done, and when. If the plan fails to give an appropriate and practical answer to one of these questions, it is likely that it does not get implemented. For this reason, spatial prioritizations are usually done on demand and from a particular point of view. This means that they essentially are case studies with a limited focus, and although they can inform local actions, they tend to miss the bigger picture of conservation needs. However, also prioritizations done with a limited scope can feed into large-scale land use planning. For example, conservation planning targeting a single habitat type can be included in a regional land use plan. Any well-conducted spatial prioritization provides invaluable information for policymakers. Even if the proposed actions were not undertaken, the information contained in and revealed by a spatial analysis is valued if it gets mainstreamed and reaches the decision makers. Spatial prioritizations also provide a flexible toolset that is used by various organizations, including non-governmental organizations or NGOs. Okay, let's have a look on the components of spatial land use planning using conservation planning as an example. Generally, the need for spatial conservation planning emerges from larger scale land use planning needs and goals. These range widely in scope from regional plans to international conservation targets, such as the so-called Aichi biodiversity goals and targets that were set to be reached on year 2020. The Aichi goals and targets were defined as part of the Convention on Biological Diversity, and they include both general goals and more specific conservation targets for the signatory countries. The individual countries then are expected to put the goals into action through their national means. Some of the Aichi targets are directly linked to land use planning and conservation. For example, the Aichi goal B is to reduce the direct pressures on biodiversity and promote sustainable use, and Aichi goal C is to improve the status of biodiversity by safeguarding ecosystem species and genetic diversity. Under this latter goal, we have, for example, Aichi target 11 that is directly linked to spatial conservation planning. Target 11 states that by 2020, at least 17% of terrestrial and inland water and 10% of coastal and marine areas, especially areas of particular importance for biodiversity and ecosystem services, are conserved through effectively and equitably managed ecologically representative and well-connected systems of protected areas and other effective area-based conservation measures, and integrated into the wider landscapes and seascapes. So what has happened then? What is the situation in reality in now, 2021? Well, conservation goals and plans are implemented through existing policies, which means they need to be adapted to existing national level governance. And in the case of Aichi Target 11, the CBD's webpages tell us that out of the 196 countries that are contributing to the target, vast majority has not reported their progress at all. 9 countries report that they are exceeding the target. 39 countries are meeting the target, 31 report an insufficient rate, 3 countries report no progress, and 1 country is moving away from the target. So clearly the IG target 11 has proven to be difficult to put into reality, and the global goal has left unachieved. Here, spatial conservation planning can provide and has already provided some help and functional tools. As we have learned, the process of spatial conservation planning is very discursive. The spatial dimension brings the high-end conservation goals to the grassroots level as it asks where conservation should be done. So the where question is valuable. The collaborative nature of spatial planning means that if conducted well, spatial conservation planning is also able to indirectly affect national policies on conservation instruction, monitoring, inspection, and so forth. These are the very policies through which plans are implemented. In this way, the practical act of planning not only feeds into reality, but it can have a transformative potential on the policies themselves. These interactions form a self-refining loop in this graph and indicate that the system of land use planning is able to adapt and develop. However, this calls for connections among different parts of the planning system. If the planning action gap exists, it breaks the links that allow for the systemic adaptation and development, or perhaps we could even speak about systemic learning. Okay, spatial conservation planning has great potential, but it is difficult to put the plans into action. That is true. Luckily, there are some guidelines for building successful planning processes and enable planning conservation actions. The same guidelines work also as tips on how to overcome the planning action gap. The first good practice is to identify the key stakeholders for the planning process. These stakeholders are people who want the assessment to be done and who can help to define the needs that are to be met with the plan. And the second good practice is to situate the spatial prioritization techniques within a broader implementation model so that it can be tied to the context of conservation action that is planned. Third good practice is to involve experts and implementers in the spatial prioritization. We need both of them. Fourth good practice is to identify conservation opportunities, not simply conservation priorities. This we have already seen in our cost analysis lecture. Fifth good practice then is to translate spatial prioritization outputs into planning products for end users. This is the mainstreaming part of the process. You shouldn't end at the output that zonation gives with the rank maps and performance curves. You need to popularize those. You need to develop informative, discussion-oriented result representations out of those sort of raw results of a prioritization. Sixth good practice is to complement planning products with an implementation strategy. This means tying the results into practice. Seventh good practice is to promote mainstreaming and enabling. And eighth good practice is to establish social learning institutions to support tools and products. I will talk a bit more about social learning in the next slide. And finally, it is important to participate in so-called adaptive management process that fine-tunes the conservation plan so that it can deliver effective conservation action in the long term. And at this point, it is good to note that there are quite a lot of people involved in the implementation of conservation planning. Now we perhaps see the process of conservation planning in a new light. It is no longer a scientific process which engages the society. Now it has revealed its true nature as a complex social process informed by science. Because of this, conservation planning needs inter- or transdisciplinary approaches. To reach conservation activities that match the goals, collaboration is key, and that means researchers need to work not only with land use managers and planners, but also with other stakeholders. It is not enough to inform the stakeholders, and it is not enough to get them involved. A truly successful conservation initiative is one that empowers its stakeholders. In this way, local people can take charge of the conservation action and commit to it in a totally new way. This, to the current knowledge and understanding, is the only way that allows for the long-term realization of the overall conservation goal, the persistence and resilience of biodiversity. This sounds great, doesn't it? However, getting to the upright corner of the figure is not easy. And the process does not proceed linearly, but iteratively. This means it takes time and effort to develop and implement successful conservation plans. The fact is that researchers don't know everything. We have to learn from the stakeholders, and we have to be open and listen and discuss about the opinions and perceptions of other people. And this takes time. There is an important trade-off in conservation planning, and this trade-off is located between temporal resources and the level of stakeholder collaboration and social learning. With limited timescale, it is impossible to reach a deep, empowered state of collaboration. And this is hard for conservation because conservation is a crisis-oriented action that usually needs to be very reactive. And when you need to react to threats, when you need to save the species from extinction, you don't have the time. And this trade-off is at the core of conservation planning and implementation of conservation plans. How much time do you have to develop a good conservation plan, and how much time do you have to implement it? So time is at the heart of conservation planning and conservation implementation and conservation in general. Thank you for viewing. We will continue in part two.
there is a motorcycle.
I don't know if you can see it, but there is a deer. Probably you can't see it. Soon.